They are fantastic. I mean, we should really help them. I trained these farmers in the 1990s. I'm so happy that until today, they're still alive, functioning and growing. I was the one providing technical assistance to the leadership of this movement way back in the 1990s. The fact that they can then, they are not the type to take advantage of disasters like Ebola.
So they have branches here in...
Yeah. We're actually planning to distribute the rest of us here. We're going to restart a kind of trading system, which will probably also help finance the campaign. Sorry, I'm tired. So anyway, but what I'm saying is that such farmers do exist. They are a large exception to the majority. Because for me, for example, it's ridiculous to sell a lupati. Do you know what a lupati is? You know, lupati is like, I was shocked, 120 pesos a kilo. A lupati is like a weed. You can almost, it's so difficult to kill it. And you're selling it at 120 pesos a kilo, it can survive under flooding conditions. Like, you know. Anyway, that's a whole other story. You can go on. Because this is my background, agriculture.
Siguro we can have 3 more questions.
Okay.
There's one more here online.
Sure.
What can you do about, what's your stand on the BFA? Strengthen or scrap it?
Okay. First, I think the way it's being practiced now, I think needs to be stopped. There's a lot of violations of the Business Forces Agreement in here. Mm-hmm. And there are actual de facto violations of the Philippine Constitution, which they have tried to actually, you know, increasing terms. There's some American soldiers that are getting involved in battle, not just training. There are all kinds of violations, so I think it has to be stopped. It has to be renegotiated. And in connection with this, we have to ask, the new government will ask the government of the United States, what is your geopolitical intent in this country? And we also have to be very clear, what is our geopolitical intent with the world? Mm-hmm. Do the two match? We will end the era that the Philippines is just a geopolitical pawn of any of the superpowers, whether it's China, which it has become under the Arroyo administration. I really have to point that out.
Yes.
Because the ZTE, you cannot understand the ZTE deal, the South Rail, the North Rail, the investment of Chinese in mining, unless you understand that there was a geopolitical deal when Arroyo lost the support of the United States. We have to be proud of our own capacity to stand as a nation and negotiate on that basis. Because we will continue to be the laughing stock of the world if we just become the ally. You know, I was so sad, Gina was so happy that she became the kind of spokesperson for ASEAN, for the United States. And that's not an achievement at all. It just shows you how subservient we are to larger powers because we cannot believe in our capacity to stand on our own self, but on our own feet. That's why for me, a prelude to foreign policy is to demonstrate that we can take care of our poverty, of our corruption, of our problems, so that when we negotiate on equal terms from one nation to another, not in a kind of instrumental fashion to make us the pawn or the instrument of larger power because we need aid. I think it's a mendicant policy, shows a lack of belief in our capacity as a nation, and I'm going to put an end to that. On the other hand, if there are, since no nation is an island, if there are genuine needs for foreign relations, which there are, then it will be on the basis of mutual respect and mutual benefit. Not like this one-sided relationship that we have right now with the visa process agreement. I'm not saying that there will be no relationship with the United States. What I'm saying is that we have to redefine the relationship with the U.S. on the basis of mutual respect and, you know, respect for our dignity as a country and the clarity of what we want in the world.
Hello, Ak. Are you open to revisiting the Mutual Defense Treaty of 1950, the very first bilateral treaty we have signed? Question from
I think as we move into the future, the geopolitical situation in the world is also moved. If you are going to sign a treaty with the United States, we have to sign it on the basis of actual conditions today and not use a past as a model. And we conceptualize the treaty on that basis. So for example, the 1950 treaty was clearly understood, and we were still under, although we were declared independent, we were not really independent of the United States. We were just one of the stepping ground. In fact, the Clark Air Base in the Subic Bay was the staging center of American presence in Africa and Asia. I mean, that was the context.
Okay.
We will redefine all of that. And we cannot go back to the past, where we, in a sense, we were lackeys of the United States. We have to go back, we have to move forward to the future, where we are a self-respecting nation, wanting an equitable relationship, a really mutually beneficial relationship with another power.
There's another question about the labor sector.
Okay.
Ano ang posisyon ni Nicanor Perlas ukol sa contractualization sa sektor ng mga manggagawa at handa ba niyang kilalanin ang right to strike bilang karapatan din ng mga manggagawa at pamahalaan?
Yes to both. Yes to the right of workers to strike and to organize, and no to contractualization. I think we have to develop creative ways to actually ensure that we develop a kind of security of tenure of employees as long as they do not violate, they don't use it as, they don't use the tenure as a way to abuse. So there will be also a possibility for administrative pieces of people who don't live up to their performance. So that it's not just a one-sided agreement, the business interests are not also activated. But to continue the practice of casualization like many malls are doing, I don't think it's, you know, every time I speak to the workers in the mall and different malls around the country, are you a casual for 6 months and then you replace? And they say yes. And so I think the malls are really very rich. I mean, they're super rich. In fact, sometimes, anyway, I'm not going to describe the affluence anymore. They can actually afford to be people, employees, real possibility for promotions, engagement. Yeah.
Okay, he has the last question. Anybody else would like to ask?
I have another question.
Okay, he wants to be the last part to ask.
You'll be the last one.
Okay.
Will there be big catches in the Nicanor Perlas administration?
Definitely. No one is immune. The big fish will be caught. But there will be an attempt before to warn people that this is administration that will walk its talk. Because that's my part of my character. I don't say things that I don't agree with and that I don't really believe in. I mean, it's plastic. I mean, I'm not a plastic person. In the past, I've always said, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do this. So, when I'm there in office, I'm going to warn people, if you violate the laws and corruption, we will run after you. And there are no exceptions. In fact, I just want to state this, that people in my whole campaign who thought I was that serious have actually been removed.